live in a constant state of fear and misery. What is up, punks? It's Shinobi, and we are bringing you a special edition of Block Digest on Monday, August 10th. We have Mr. Chris Belcher here today, and sadly, I'm not going to be able to grace you with the folk ballad song that I keep trolling you about because I lazily still haven't written it yet.
Folk ballad song?
Well, I think that, you know, Belcher is an underappreciated MVP in this space, and I think he needs a folk ballad.
Maybe that's good. Privacy isn't bad, after all.
Well, there is a new thing called Bardcore. I don't know if you've seen Hildegard von Bingen yet.
Wait, what? I can do this with more instruments than just a guitar?
Shinobi, don't you remember when I showed you that song that it was a medieval version of Pumped Up Kicks?
Oh! I think the musical direction of this is taking a whole new direction in my head, Belcher. Alrighty, though. Trolling aside. Yeah, so you are working on a coin swap implementation. So, want to kind of just dive into what really motivated you to finally do that? Because, you know, if you pull this off first, I think this makes you the first person to implement coin join and then also coin swap, both of Greg Maxwell's old ideas from back in the day.
Yeah, that would be. So actually, CoinSwap has been implemented before once in a not very well-known implementation. It was kind of a toy in some ways. And that was written by Waxwing in Python. You can find it on his GitHub called CoinSwap CS. But it had lots of... So the way I see CoinSwap, it is one great idea, but it needed lots of other building blocks to make it really properly work. So for example, a big thing is a DOS attack. Like you could... I'll just go into that briefly, which is if Alice and Bob are doing a coin swap, they have to both put money in a multi-sig address. And what you could end up is that one of the people backs out just at the last, you know, the last minute, and then the person who's put their money in the multi-sig address first, they have to waste time and have to waste minor fees in order to get their money back. So you could call that a DOS attack, a denial of service. And that was not really solved so far, and I think I've told that there's a way. And also for CoinJoin, there are other older CoinJoin implementations, so that wasn't me either, unfortunately. But hopefully I can be the first widely used one. I can aim for that.
Well, I stand corrected.
Yeah, it's funny, there's a lot of these little-known implementations that are kind of, people make them to play around with the ideas, and then they just kind of, yeah, like they're toys, they kind of give up and don't go, and people don't never use them. I have to be honest, Join Market started like that. That I said, I had the idea of having a liquidity market of a maker and a taker for coin joins and kind of coded it up over 2 weeks or so. But then to my surprise, lots of people actually started using it. Well, like actual real Bitcoins, not just testnet Bitcoins. So then it kind of became a real project, you could put it that way. It wasn't meant to be. Carry on.
I was just going to say, so it's kind of a happy accident.
Yeah. And someone joked with me, they said maybe Bitcoin itself was like that. Maybe Satoshi just wanted to, you know, make a toy implementation of, you know, gold money and digital way, what was called Bitcoin. And then people started using it for real. I guess we'll never know.
Well, the Bitcoin wizard definitely gives that impression.
Hey, real quick, guys, can we hold for a second? And I'm going to try to reconnect to my VPN. This is really fucked, but my ping time went up through a ClearNet connection rather than down.
Yeah, sure, I'll wait.
All right, yeah, that is a really strange thing. Adding a VPN just cut my ping time in half. I really don't know what to make of that.
Very interesting. I wonder if it's... what, you know, not net neutrality, but that you're being throttled because you're not on a VPN.
Well, I guess that's really my only thought. So yeah, I guess to kind of, you know, pick back up with a little better audio quality. You kind of want to break down, why it really took so long to kind of move from all of these coin join implementations to working on CoinSwap, and kind of all the complexities there that really kind of stalled that progress-wise.
Yeah, so I think many people were first working on coin joins because they're relatively easy to implement. So a coin join is one transaction. You can, if you have a coin join implementation, you just have many people agree to make this one transaction, and they all sign it, and then you broadcast it, and then you're basically the coin join implementation is finished. It doesn't have to monitor confirmations, and it doesn't have to monitor the blockchain or anything like that. It just makes a transaction. That's that. It broadcasts it. So that's a lot easier than CoinSwap. So a really big thing with CoinSwap is that you have to interact with people across different blocks. So you have to talk with your application has to talk with another application. Then it broadcasts a transaction. Then has to wait for it to be confirmed, and after that, it will talk to them again to do more communication. That's one source of complexity. But also, it could just be why did CoinJoin come first? Just because it was the simpler thing, and people go for the simpler thing first. Like, okay, so back, I don't know, in 2013 and 14, there was no privacy solution that didn't involve trusting a third party. Like, who could steal your coins? I mean, there were those centralized mixers. And then the first idea, okay, we need something good. Let's just try CoinJoin. It's the simplest thing, and we can work from that. And eventually, people iterate. They make the next thing better and better. And I think now it's just time to go for CoinSwap.
Yeah, and so, fundamentally, I think when you really look at coin joins and coin swaps, they're kind of like the polar opposite in terms of on-chain privacy models. Like, you have coin joins that are just obscuring the input and output graphs, although blatantly doing so. And then, coin swap, ideally, if you have the right primitives, you just swap two unrelated coins on chain without kind of tying anything together in terms of metadata footprint on chain.
Yeah, that's right. And CoinJoin has other there's lots of other downsides. So they use quite a lot of block space. So I'll explain that a bit. There's two kind of main ways of CoinJoins now, which is either there's fixed denominations, which is what Wasabi and Samurai do, where there's a fixed CoinJoin amount. So for example, Wasabi is 0.1 Bitcoin, and all the CoinJoins are for that amount. And that uses a lot of block space because having this fixed denomination damages the divisibility of Bitcoin. You can't send any amount, you can only send 0.1, which means, for example, if you have 0.6 and you want to coin join them all, you have to make six coin joins, right? 0.1 six times to get 0.6. So that will immediately, you've had to use six times as much block space than if you just sent a transaction normally. So join market doesn't have that because it has this liquidity market. But in join market, the market makers, they would have never had made a transaction anyway. Like, their coins would have been happy sitting in their wallet, never moving, until the market taker came along and created a coin join. So the transactions are bigger from there, like, you because of that reason. So the taker, if they weren't using coin join, they would have made a transaction with, I don't know, one input and two, and then with a coin join and join market, they have maybe 10 inputs and 20 outputs. So it's a lot bigger already. So block space is a big reason, a big downside of coin joins compared to coin swaps. Another downside, which is really important, is that these equal output coin joins are really detectable, that it's really obvious that this thing is happening, that all the output amounts are, or at least many of the output amounts have the same amount. And you can, there's lots of inputs as well, and lots of change addresses. And therefore, those kind of transactions can be centered, like, either by the miners or by someone who receives those coins. Like, we've seen exchanges doing that for Wasabi coin joins. Another downside they have is they leak the change address of in a coin join. So in the example of Wasabi and Samurai, if you don't have 0.1 Bitcoin exactly, suppose you have 0.15, then you'll do a coin join for 0.1, and you'll have 0.05 left over as a change address. And that still leaks information, and then you have to be careful to solve it. Now with Join Market, you can do, because there's the liquidity market, which allows you to make coin joins for any amount, it's possible to do a sweep coin join, where you essentially, if you're a market taker, you create a coin join which has no change address. So for example, you had one Bitcoin and your coin join will be for 0.999 whatever, like one Bitcoin minus fees, and there'll be no change address. So then the taker won't leak the change address there, but all the market makers will. So they'll have their leak change address, and then there's that leaks a little bit of information, and there have been attacks of people using that. And CoinSwap doesn't have this either, because the CoinSwap transactions just look like regular transactions. So that I'll just summarize. I think I mentioned four reasons that the CoinJoin uses a lot more block space. It's detectable and it leaks change addresses, and leaks inputs actually. So. Well, no, okay. Let's just, yeah, call it those three reasons: change addresses, detectability, and block space. That's why CoinSwap is better.
Yeah, and it's, the one thing I think, or like the first thing in your implementation proposal, I think that really kind of drives that home to a true statement is looking at using two-party ECDSA schemes, because prior to that, you're kind of fingerprinting things already if you were to use a two of two multi-sig or even a fake two of three. And that drastically, reduces the overall anonymity set that can really blend in with the chain. And, one thing I'm kind of thinking here in terms of, the actual implementation you're going for is I know there's a couple different multi-party ECD SA schemes out there. And I know that there's a lot of, other projects in the space kind of looking at utilizing those for different things. You have people in the Lightning community looking at that. And then you have Commerce Block trying to apply, I think, Lindell's scheme for their variation of a state chain that could be deployed right now. Like, have you really given much thought in terms of which actual implementation you're going to use? Thinking through like how interoperable or compatible that could be with other schemes, using that in the space?
Yeah, I've given a little bit of thought. All I've done is I've got the notes here. I've read the paper by Lindell, which seems to be a starting point for most of this stuff. And there's a talk that I think he or someone related to the paper gave, and I watched that. And there's a Rust implementation that someone from the Lightning Labs wrote, which I kind of glanced over. But apart from that, I haven't given it. I think that's probably the best way. This Lindell thing, 'cause it has the feature of, two of two, and it's like a two of two multisig that looks the same, and it doesn't implement things that I wouldn't really need, like adapter signatures or anything like that, or a threshold thing like k of n instead of n of n. To be honest, I haven't spent too much time on it. I think the first kind of the roadmap for this first project is to first make it with regular multisigs, to make sure all the protocol stuff works of communication and all the incentives and everything like that, the liquidity market, make sure all that works, and then the ECDSA 2P can be added on afterwards. So kind of the first version that's just on testnet will just have regular multisigs for now.
Okay, so you're just mostly looking at making sure that there's no little incentive holes in terms of the interactions during different steps before you really start thinking about that.
Yeah, and that's really important. Like, if you get anything about that wrong, people can lose money. Like the market makers who, so if you step back a bit, the point of the market makers is there's someone who owns Bitcoins, just, like a holder or something. They would have otherwise the coins would have stayed in their cold storage, but they choose to put them in this CoinSwap maker to earn income from that, like having a share give you dividends or something. And they're not really this group are not going to accept if there's any risk that there's any possibility of losing money. So I'm that just involves checking the protocols and making sure things like the equivalent of watchtowers in Lightning that works properly and that's designed properly.
All right, so kind of like the only way I can really think to do this is kind of slow step by step because I'm not gonna lie, it's kind of counterintuitive even for me trying to think this through. But like in the implementation spec that you wrote out, you kind of slow walk your way from a very basic implementation into this very complex kind of routable scheme. And, obviously the problem with the most naive implementation is if you and me both put, 15 Bitcoin in swap addresses and then succeed and finalize the coin swap, that's correlatable. And so your notion from there is just a maker using individual UTXOs in separate transactions to break, the amount correlation on chain. And then that still leaves that maker aware of where all your coins actually went. So you kind of propose the idea of routing through multiple makers atomically. And you don't really kind of spell out in the specification here, like how you actually intend to implement an HTLC in terms of hopping through multiple makers. And I'm kind of wondering, like, how exactly would that work without the potential for fingerprintable scripts or linkages between transactions potentially hitting chain?
So there is a thing. If an important part of CoinSwap is that it's quite undesirable for the contract transaction, so the transaction which actually contains the timeout and the hash lock part, to end up on chain. So a lot of the incentives are around trying to make that as rare as possible. And the way the routing works is it's very similar to Lightning, that each of the makers in the route, they lock up their coins in a multi-sig reverse, and they can get them back if they either from the they can get them back from the next taker, from the next peer, if they provide a hash value, or from the previous taker if they wait for a timeout. And then once the hash value is known to everyone, then it's like the coins have all jumped forward one step.
Okay, so you're like literally talking about an explicit HTLC in its own transaction, and the idea just being that hopefully everybody just cooperates, and at no point does that hit chain. So you're kind of thinking load into the coin swap address, then from that point actually have a transaction that would dump things into the HTLC, and ideally in a success, people cooperatively sign and just bypass that completely.
Yeah, exactly like that. And it's based on more than just hope. I'm trying to make it based on incentives, so that I've got a design I'm working on, which I'm going to send to the mailing list soon, which is about that talks about the actual numbers, so that if like there's a cooperative case, then all the makers will earn their coin swap fee, and they won't pay anything in minor fees. But if there's a problem, for example, if all the HTLCs are broadcast and people have to wait for the timeout, not only do they waste time, but they also have to pay minor fees, and they don't earn their coin swap fee. So for the makers, there's a strong incentive for them to actually make the protocol succeed in a way. Like, they have an incentive to try and reconnect again if they lose connection. They have an incentive to wait along, wait minutes in case the other guy's internet stopped working or something. And for the taker, they obviously have an incentive because they really want privacy. So I'd hope, I mean, I'm gonna, when I email it to the list, then people can review that, but I hope that the incentives all align so that everyone just works together and these transactions never hit the chain.
Okay, so that's kind of like a major difference in terms of CoinSwap and CoinJoin's privacy models. In terms of, if a CoinJoin fails for some reason, potentially I've revealed a little bit of information to the coordinator or other peers related to an input, but I'm not really revealing anything at large to the public. Whereas here, if a coin swap kind of failed, then you pretty much have the entire linkage of the attempted coin swap hit chain, correct?
Yeah, that's right.
So, I mean, doesn't that kind of potentially pose a systemic risk if somebody were to try and grief makers in terms of definitively doxing UTXOs that are involved in coin swaps? I know part of your proposal is that makers could effectively pull the same trick that CoinJoin does, where you just have a bunch of fake inputs that you send to the taker, And then, if this doesn't actually succeed, then they have to kind of guess out of this whole mess of fake UTXOs which one is real. A coin swap failing would kind of publicly dox like all of these UTXOs are involved in coin swaps right now. So wouldn't that kind of present an issue for those UTXOs being used in swaps in future if that were to happen?
Yeah, so there's two different things you've mixed together there. So the thing you're talking about sending random inputs back and forth, that's related to the idea of a pay join with CoinSwap, where somebody, the taker or one of the makers, pays into a CoinSwap address with a coin join. And then that also breaks the common input ownership heuristic. And to make any kind of coin join, you have to send inputs forth and then sign the whole transaction. And then the attack is that a malicious taker could spy on the makers and figure out their inputs without spending any money. And then the solution for that attack is to use the decoy inputs, where the maker sends many random inputs that don't belong to them. But the thing we were talking about earlier was the CoinSwap HDLCs actually end up on chain if there's a problem. And I think you were asking about an attack where there's a malicious taker and he wants to make coin joins. Say he makes a coin join with all the maker, sorry, he makes a this malicious taker makes a coin swap with all the makers and then intentionally stops the coin swap so that all their HDLCs have to hit the chain. Yes, that attack is possible. And there's at least two defenses I can think of it. One is that to do this, the taker would have to first spend their own miner fees. So to do this to every maker in the order book, they'd have to like to do it repetitively, constantly. They'd have to constantly spend miner fees to do that. And maybe, maybe that will be cheap. Maybe depending, it could be cheap, could be expensive. So that maybe that's not too good of a defense. But to start with, I think it'll be quite good. And then the second defense, which is better for long term, will be instead of to have hash time lock contracts, to wait for Schnorr to be added to Bitcoin, and then you can do point time lock contracts, and then you could have contracts which are like HDLCs, but they work with Schnorr signatures and adapter signatures. And then if they end up on chain, they just look like a regular Schnorr signature, with a time lock. So there's no, they look like anything else, and then that fingerprinting there for the whole world to see.
Yeah, that would definitely be a much preferred implementation detail. But prior to Schnorr, my concern is that a malicious taker could grief makers, and the like my concern here isn't so much like makers losing money beyond fees. It's the fact that those get tagged as coin swap coins. And so now, from that point on, heuristically, somebody like a chain analytics company could assume where these coins go, a coin swap is involved. And so that becomes a basis to assign taint to them. And that would incur a cost for the makers in terms of like how do they clean that up? Like now, outside of coin swap, they have to find some way to disassociate that UTXO with that taint, or that's a basis to start blacklisting. You know what I mean? Like we could, like somebody could grief a coin swap, tag all of these makers' UTXOs, and now just make an assumption now that these are all the outputs of coin swaps going forward.
Yeah, you're right. That is a definite possible attack. But for this griefing, they would have to pay money for it. So to grief one maker, they have to pay one miner fee for the amount. And then, to grief all the makers, suppose there's 20 or 30 makers in the order book. And right now in joint market, there's about 60 or 100. They'd have to spend 60 or 100 or however many makers there are, they'd have to spend that many miner fees. And not just once, but they have to do it constantly. So every time one of these guys makes a new transaction, this malicious taker would have to do it again and spend more miner fees. So it's not a free attack. And I doubt it's going to happen straight away. And hopefully by the time the attackers wise up, we'll already have Schnorr, and then we'll use point time lock contracts instead of hash time lock contracts.
All right, then kind of another aspect of the whole routing these through multiple makers is you also go into the notion of kind of condensing UTXOs or fanning them out through the process of a coin swap. And you know, one of the things that kind of jumped out at me is looking at the notion of I was kind of trying to walk through the implementation spec kind of step by step, but I think I'm going to kind of jump a little bit ahead to the page join stuff too. You're looking at the notion of if I have, say, two UTXOs that I don't want tied together under any circumstances, then I just route them through a coin swap to wind up with a single UTXO. And my concern there, when you start looking at the notion of page joins inside of coin swaps, can you really be sure that those two UTXOs don't wind up in the same transaction? Like, I mean, potentially one is swapped somewhere, and then that coin winds up coming back and being involved in a page join like coin swap. Because, like, ultimately, even though I've disintermediated myself from those coins, like, I have completely separate ones. From a Chainalysis point of view, if one of those coins was KYC'd or tied to me in a cluster and was eventually combined with the other one, I mean, they would make that interpretation that I had both of those coins. And despite that not being true right now, that was true at some point.
That's an interesting point that the so I guess concretely what would happen there is you have a UTXOs A and B, you don't want them together, and you send A with a coin swap to one person and then B with a coin swap to another person, and then you do a coin swap and that's all finished. Then someone else comes along and they make a rooted coin swap and it uses both of those makers, and then both of those makers together to a pay join between them, and just by chance your coin swapped UTXOs, like one transaction ahead, get pay joined together. And yeah, then that would you could argue that would be evidence that they're owned by the same person. But I guess they're not in that case, they're not you're right, like that could happen. But you'd have to be tricked by this. We'd already be in an environment where pay joins are very, very popular. I guess somehow like a lot of things have to line up for that to really happen. And I suppose you could say, okay, under no circumstances, I don't want any of my UTXOs to have evidence that they're the same person, that they're co-owned. Then yeah, I guess that is a yeah, you're right, that is a real attack. Although I'd argue in an environment where pay joins are popular, then that kind of evidence won't really be evidence. Like in that case, the common input ownership heuristic would just be broken at that point.
Well, I mean, hopefully, I mean, that's the end result I'd like to see. But you know what I mean? I just kind of work on the assumption that these companies are still going to keep clinging to these things that make them look valuable as a service. And you know, it's just kind of little edge case stuff like this. I don't really see coin swap so much as superior to coin join. I see it as just the other end of the spectrum. And I see a lot of potential synergy here. You know what I mean? Like, for instance, in this kind of hypothetical situation, I could coin join one of those UTXOs to introduce ambiguity there and then go into a coin swap to condense things so that there is that extra kind of plausible deniability if this were to occur down the line. You know what I mean?
Right, yeah. So by doing an equal output coin join there, you're showing the world that you're doing a private like a privacy activity, but then you still get privacy. You're just showing them that it's privacy. So it's like you've put on a mask and no one can see you. Well, a coin swap would be that you've somehow I don't know, the mask thing doesn't come into this analogy, but it's as if you've transformed into another person and no one knows that you even were anonymous. Like you don't wear a mask, the new person doesn't wear a mask, they just are a new person. But a thing I'm trying, a thing that I hope after CoinJoin gets really popular is that all these assumptions will break down. Like we could, I think eventually there'll come a point where people actually come up with memes. For you know how memes are a good way of spreading ideas. So for example, you could have a hashtag, how do you know it's not a coin swap? When anyone when anyone tries to do some blockchain analysis and maybe they post on Twitter or something, someone replies underneath hashtag, how do you know it's not a coin? Because that could be true anything, anytime someone does some kind of analysis, even if there's one coin swap in their whole evidence, their whole analysis, then the whole thing will be wrong. So I think, eventually you'll come to that point that we need to tell the world of how flawed their assumptions are after the thing's done, after the thing's created and people use it.
Mm-hmm. And then, one of your long-standing ideas for join market is also a big part of this spec. So the whole fidelity bond idea.
That actually came first. So I was thinking, mm-hmm. I've actually been thinking about CoinSwap for years, and it has the DOS problem I mentioned a couple of minutes ago, and fidelity bonds is the way that's solved. And I first came up with the fidelity bonds as a solution to DOS. And then I realized later it also can be used as a solution to Sybil attacks. And then I realized that can also be applied to join market. So I wrote up that document about a year ago. It's been now for join market. And the idea was that join market would be kind of, I'd first try out there. It would be an experiment to see how it works. And then later it will be used for CoinSwap. And that's probably how I'll do it. Like, I think right now I will write the CoinSwap project to have a lot of the features, but not fidelity bonds yet. And then I'll go back and finish implementing fidelity bonds on join market. And they're actually mostly implemented already. And then kind of release that into the wild and people can see how that works, if it gets uptake and that kind of thing. And we as a community will gain experience with fidelity bonds. And then I'll go back and add them into CoinSwap as well. We can talk about that. I quite like that idea. It was a really fun thing to come up with and invent. Especially the V squared thing.
Yeah, I mean, because it's, especially when you look at like CoinJoin versus CoinSwap, I think that the fidelity bond issue is way more important with CoinSwap because, a CoinJoin denial of service doesn't really incur on-chain costs. It's just a privacy leak and a waste of time. Whereas here, you're kind of irrevocably committing yourself to that on-chain cost once you enter the contract.
Yeah, for the DOS, definitely for CoinSwap, it's more important. But then using fidelity bonds as a way to resist Sybil attacks, I'd argue is important for both of them. Because if you realize today, in Wasabi and Samurai Wallet, they can Sybil attack their users for almost for free. It doesn't cost them very much at all. All that you need to do is, for example, if the Wasabi company gets it's forced by some government to, if you watch this UTXO, then you have to Sybil attack it, then they'll be able to do that. So the UTXO comes along and wants to do a coin join, and the Wasabi server sends all its own inputs that all belong to it, 99 of them or however many they are. And then the owner of that UTXO, they'll think everything's okay and sign the transaction, and they'll think they're taking part in a 100-party coin join. But because all the other 99 parties are actually owned by Wasabi, they'll easily tell which is the one output left over, and they'll know where the UTXO went, and that's basically the definition of a Sybil attack. But because Samurai and Wasabi are centralized, the only person who can do this is the coordinator, the server. While in join market, the way you do a Sybil attack is to flood the liquidity market with your own Sybils, and for that you also need to own a bit of Bitcoins. But if like I've done the maths, it's not very costly at all, really. And then fidelity bonds as a way that massively increases the cost of it. Like if I remember the numbers, it's something like 500 million have to be locked up for a couple of months in like $500 million have to be locked up in Bitcoin for a couple of months, which is a huge cost.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's mostly, I don't know. See, my concern here is that, is that cost going to wind up being too high?
Well, it's set by the, what do you mean by too high exactly?
Well, I mean, implicitly by locking up if you're a maker in a system like join market or a coin swap market like this, I mean, obviously your interest here is to make a return on your capital. But locking things up in a fidelity bond is kind of, you're limiting the amount of capital that you can generate a return on. So like, it's been a while since I looked at the fidelity bond write-up that you did, but you know, like what was your thinking in terms of like arriving at a cost for that, in terms of the opportunity cost of like I am a real entity that isn't being sibled, but not really incurring too high of a cost there to disincentivize?
Right, I see what you mean. You're saying that because of this, there may be not enough liquidity in the liquidity market because much of it's gone to Fidelity bonds. So for that, I guess that could be possible. So what's the situation in Join Market right now is it's possible to create coin joins up to like just over 200 bitcoins, and then if you want really lots of liquidity, like many many bots, like 20 or 30, then you have to. The limit is at 40 bitcoins, and that's still a very big amount, like 400, more than $400,000. You can make a coin join for that with loads and loads of liquidity. So if even if the liquidity falls a bit, it will still be very useful for people. I mean, I don't know about you, $400,000 is like a lot of money, and I don't coin join that, you know, every day or ever. But it could be if the available liquidity falls a bit, then I think there's like headroom there to lose a bit of liquidity. And secondly, what we can try, you can notice now that Join Market is barely advertised at all. Like very few people know about it. I think I don't know. It's mentioned not much at all. And yet there's still all this liquidity there. So essentially, right now, it's only people who've been in the space for, you know, who read every obscure email and Twitter thread and Reddit post, and they know about Join Market, and not many other people do. So I think you can remedy that by just having a bit of an advertising campaign, having some, you know, going around giving talks, going around sending emails and that kind of thing, saying, hey, if you have bitcoins, you can lock them up here and you get money for basically doing nothing, just maintaining this maker. And I think that would make a lot more liquidity flood in if we find out it's lacking. So a third kind of a related point is a big reason we don't have more liquidity today with Join Market is that the market doesn't need it. That basically anyone who wants to create a coin join can do so, even up to, as I said, up to about 200 bitcoins. So there's no incentive for more people to come in, if you see what I mean. And I'm kind of confident, although I guess we'll see, but I'm quite confident that when it comes to a shortage of liquidity, then the price of coin joins will go up, or coin swaps, and that'll just motivate more people to go in.
Okay. Yeah, that's a pretty good argument.
Yeah, market-based, right?
Well, I mean, that was kind of the whole core of the idea in the first place, and it seems to be working so far.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. Let's see, what else can we get into? So I know that you're looking at succinct atomic swaps in terms of kind of both just being more efficient with chain space, but also at the same time trying to deal with kind of the temporal fingerprint of like it, you know, into this address, out to this address, and that being something that could potentially identify a coin swap. So like that's obviously going to require watchtower infrastructure. So, like, what's your thinking along those lines? Like, are you planning on kind of implementing standalone watchtowers for this, or potentially get involved in some of the discussions about watchtower standardization? You know, that so that way you can kind of avoid the problem of, you know, a single watchtower for each individual protocol it's involved in.
Yeah, I see what you mean. So watchtowers, I think, would be required even if succinct atomic swaps are not used. So they could just be required for a regular coin swap. They'd be quite useful because you could have, so a maker could have multiple of their watchtowers running on different, like running on different networks on different machines with different power supplies. So if any one of those machines, for example, gets a power cut and is unable to watch the chain, they know they have two or three other watchtowers which are protecting their money. And I think that'll be important because makers, as we said, they're basically holders. They want the least possible risk to their money, and so they just make a return with the lowest possible risk. So yeah, I guess they'll be using watchtowers just to defend against stuff like power cuts and internet cutouts. Now, as for succinct atomic swaps, I wrote about them a bit in the original document, but I don't think they'll use them actually that much. So the effect you talked about of unlinking the time. So you can have money go into a coin swap and then it cannot be paid out indefinitely, could stay there unspent forever in theory. You can get that same effect by using private key handover. And that's a thing where when there's money in a, suppose I have money in a 2 of 2 multisig and I have one of the keys, if the other person gives me his private key as well, then I'll have 2 of the 2 private keys. And I effectively unilaterally control that money because I have both private keys. And then you get the same effect that the coins can remain unsever.
But I mean, it's because, like, you know, I would say, like, wouldn't you want to use those as much as possible wherever the taker and makers involved were willing to support such a thing? Because, I mean, you know, that it really would be kind of, I don't know. You know, it's the same kind of thing with PayJoin. You know what I mean? Like, it breaks one heuristic in the sense that you destroy common input ownership. But then it, in my mind, inevitably creates a new heuristic as those things roll up into the merchant or the receiver's UTXOs if they're receiving a lot. Like, I see the same kind of potential for that temporal linkage here. You know, when if you just have this string of coins that's constantly just hopping at somewhat regular intervals and never stopping, you know what I mean? So, like, I really see this succinct atomic swap application here as kind of really necessary in terms of, you know, doing the best you can to really stop creating a new heuristic that people can look at.
I don't know how succinct atomic swaps adds anything to what private key handover does. Like, with, you're talking about a coin hopping many times, but they that would happen with succinct atomic swap, if I'm not wrong.
Well, I mean, isn't the entire gist of the succinct atomic swap you just hand over the key and then, you know, watch from there?
Yeah, and you can do that with private key handover. Like, the thing of succinct atomic swaps is it also contains some crypto stuff, like some elliptic curve calculations that make the whole thing work. And then you get to that effect that you can leave a coin unspent forever. But you can get the same effect of leaving a coin unspent forever if you use private key handover.
Okay. Yeah, I see what you mean here. And that, but, you know, to kind of continue down, like, the temporal route in terms of, like, implementation details, like, have you given any thought in terms of, you know, the actual software that makers would operate to kind of do careful UTXO selection to maybe introduce some kind of randomness in the rate at which coins are moving or which UTXOs have sat here for how long or things like that?
Yeah, I've thought of that. There could be, I guess it will be somewhat similar to how it's in Join Market today, but there could be more. We'd have to think a lot more carefully because with CoinSwap, you can have the great effect that the transactions can look the same as any other transaction. So we'd have, so maybe a good idea, for example, is to analyze the blockchain the last 6 months or 18 months or something and see what's the average time a UTXO remains unspent for. And then you see what kind of statistical distribution that follows and use the same one for the makers, for their algorithm for choosing UTXOs or something like that. Like, there's those couple of thoughts. Or another thought would be that you can, you know, there's the wallet fingerprinting idea that you can figure out, okay, these transactions are almost certainly made by Electrum. These are certainly made by Bitcoin Core and
Ooh.
That kind of thing. And then in the maker algorithm, you say, okay, 30% of the time I'm going to pretend to be Electrum, 30% of the time I'll pretend to be Bitcoin Core, and then you have a few other wallets, and they all, obviously, they'll add up to 100%. And that could be a useful thing to break, because that thing breaks change analysis, change address heuristics. So the way change address heuristics work is that you see, you can say, okay, this input was owned by Electrum, and it's spent to two outputs, and one of them is owned by Electrum, and the other one's owned by Bitcoin Core. Therefore, the one that was Electrum is the change output because it's going back to the same wallet. And if we have this thing that intentionally breaks that, we can make an analyst think that the change output is the payment output and vice versa.
That's actually a really interesting thing I hadn't even considered. That is a good wrench to throw in the gears.
Yeah, I have to admit, though, if you guys remember my privacy article, the kind of the thing that first gave me the idea to write something like that was to document all these heuristics, or document like the change output heuristic and how for wallet fingerprinting and that kind of thing, because later I'd intend to use it for CoinSwap, because I'd already have a prepared list for it and then figure out exactly how the algorithm will go. I'm thinking back now, that privacy article's been out for like 2 years or 1 year or however long. So maybe that gives you a sign of how long I've been thinking about some of this stuff. It's been like slowly building up for ages, in fact. So I've got a memory now of in IRC, Greg Maxwell coming into the Join Market channel. It must have been like 2015 or 16, and said, "Hey, this is really good, and you could if you did it with CoinSwap, it'll be really great as well because you get the benefit of breaking the transaction graph and stuff." So it's been years and years that we've all been thinking about it, I think.
So you've just been quietly being a mad scientist in your head.
Yeah, pretty much, and of course it has to be incremental, so you can never. It's hard to do a really big jump. I suppose creating a CoinSwap implementation is a big jump, but in the first I did, I'd try and improve Join Market and figure out like the is around that, and then try and improve them a bit more incrementally and get more people to join the project and that kind of thing, and get enough donations to support myself and that kind of thing. And eventually you get. I suppose that's how engineering and science works, that you get slowly, learn more things incrementally, and but then when you look back over years, you've actually achieved a lot. That's kind of my summary of the last few years for me.
I just want to quickly mention the last trick that you mentioned kind of reminds me. I don't know if you ever used it, but there was a browser extension called Random Agent Spoofer, where it would take advantage of the fact that so many websites they try to get your user agent string and use that to track you across the web. And Random Agent Spoofer, you could set it to randomize so that it would do it for you, but you could also basically change your user agent profile. So even if you were using, Firefox on a Linux machine, you could change your profile to be, Chrome browser on a Mac. And you could also change it to a mobile profile, which was quite fun because then you could see the mobile versions of all of these websites because that's what they would serve you, assuming you were on a phone. That's what it kind of reminds me of. And I think it would be cool to have a similar thing for Bitcoin wallets for that.
Yeah, I've heard of that, and that is probably, I mean, I've known about that for ages, and that's probably what inspired me. I have to admit, I probably got the idea from that.
Oh, nice.
Sweet. All right, so yeah, I guess last kind of nitty detail of the implementation, I guess. You're kind of finally looking at moving past IRC as far as a coordination or communication layer for this. So I guess you kind of want to run through your thoughts on that.
Yeah, so as I mentioned back in the beginning, that Join Market started as kind of a toy implementation that just grew out of control. And IRC was just the first, it's kind of the first idea, the first kind of, oh, this thing won't work, let's just do that. And then with the idea that later someone would come up with a better idea, and then no one ever did. Like all the other ideas that are possible have certain problems, and IRC is still basically the way it works now. And actually, I don't think it's actually that bad. So in Join Market, we use multiple IRC servers, and it's easy for the community. Like if Join Market still has a community, then they can agree together to use another IRC server that someone sets up. And the IRC server can't, first, of course, not just one IRC server. It's right now there's three networks, and they can't do much. So all the communication is encrypted, and the only attack they can kind of do is through a Sybil attack, which is to stop if a taker comes along, they can stop that taker seeing the genuine makers and then just redirect them to the server's own makers, and then they just give them and their useless coin joins that can be unmixed. Now, so the way I had it, as you saw in the document, the way I think it will work in CoinSwap, that, and this is another reason Fidelity bonds are useful, is that there'll be a something like a web server where takers will go, they'll just go to the web server and just download the page, and that page will have the Tor onion of each maker along with their fidelity bond. And then the taker will connect all these Tor onions and download information. Like they're connecting directly to makers, and they'll download information like What the fees will be, how many, what the Bitcoin amount will be, and what the like relative fee will be, and that kind of thing. How many confirmations are required? But the reason the Fidelity bonds are there is an anti-spam measure. So the way that makers advertise themselves is they go to this HTTP server and then upload information, just their Tor onion. But if anyone can do that, then someone could run a while loop to fill up the HTTP server with just loads of random, random data and make it crash, make it use loads of disk space. But if these servers, they say that the only way you can write to them is to have a Fidelity bond, then it's no longer free to spam. Then the only way to spam is to spend loads of money on Bitcoins, which spammers won't do. And because makers already have a Fidelity bond, which they're using for anti-DOS and for Sybil protection, they can just use the same Fidelity bond here. Now, the reason I kind of thought of it this way is because these HTTP servers, so I'd call them CIDR servers, they'll probably be run by volunteers in a similar way to how the IRC servers, like they're right now in Joinmarket, they're not run by anyone related to Joinmarket, but they could be possibly one day. And what's most likely is there'll be volunteers. I guess it'll be similar to in Bitcoin Core, there's the DNS seeds, and they're run by people in the Bitcoin community, and they help new clients connect. It's that kind of model that there's people who are willing to run this thing, and it doesn't cost them too much money. Like they just have a seeder. It's a bot that goes around, and in equivalent to CoinSwap, it won't cost the volunteers too much money because they know they can't be spammed. They won't have to spend too much on disk space, and they probably won't have to spend too much on bandwidth because the messages are quite small. So I hope the incentives there are right for the thing to carry on, to work, to be sustainable.
Well, yeah, I mean, I see like a big incentive for makers to run those. I mean, if nothing else, and then the Fidelity bond would still provide a basis of like this isn't just being stacked up for free. And then, obviously you just cross compare things.
The thing of makers is that they have an incentive to censor everyone but themselves, right? Just by when no malicious things, just because they want to make more money. So I don't know, if you're a maker and your fee is 0.1%, and you see some son of a bitch over there is offering for cheaper, then you're not going to want to advertise him. You want him to be forgotten, right? So I think that these servers have to be run by different people from makers, ideally. Probably what they'll be is there'll be like a file that's included within the CoinSwap package. So you just have maybe 20 servers and they barely ever change. And they'll be run by like, maybe, not by me for centralization, but some other people who are like keen and trusted in the community. And or you have to trust that they don't, that they don't censor everyone but themselves. And if they do try and do that, then anyone could notice because the amount of offered, like the value of all the offered Fidelity bonds will drop a lot. You'll see that one day there's millions and millions of dollars locked up in Fidelity bonds, and the next day there's only, much less, 0.1 Bitcoin, and that'll be suspicious already if people start censoring.
Well, I mean, if you're doing the Fidelity bonds with a time lock, couldn't you kind of bypass this issue somewhat just by scanning the chain for time lock coins? And I mean, obviously, not all of them are going to be Fidelity bonds, but I would imagine some decent subset of them would be. So you could use that as a kind of metric for like what can I see on chain and how much of this is being represented in all of the different order book servers out there.
So there's two problems with that. One is that you can't you that would break pruning. So that would mean that anyone who uses this can't prune their blockchain, and they have to have the whole whatever 200, 300 gigabytes and growing blockchain. The other problem is that when you scan these things on chain, you can't actually see their time locked output until their money is spent. It just looks like a P2SH output or something similar.
Okay. Like I said, it's been a while since I actually looked at the Fidelity bond write-off you did.
No, that's fair. They're good suggestions, whatever. I have to say, this is quite an interesting and different podcast to the other ones because normally it's me kind of explaining the thing for people who've maybe not read the document, and this is quite interesting because you're actually kind of finding problems with it, which is really good. Like, that's good. You have to find reviews and possible problems and that kind of thing.
All right, well, I guess one other thing I kind of wanted to get into is post Schnorr. I don't really have any kind of solid or thought through structure for this, But once you bring adapter signatures into the picture, I see the potential here for synergy between coin swaps and the Lightning Network. I mean, you can already do submarine swaps between the two on chain. The issue here would just be accomplishing that without leaving a fingerprint that that's going on. And have you kind of thought through any atomic interactions between multiple layers in like the long-term design of this?
I haven't thought. So, can you explain what's the value add of combining Lightning and CoinSwap?
Well, I mean, just another way to potentially, fragment or like break up or condense amounts. I mean, it's really just another layer of liquidity. Because right here, if you're looking at if you look at Lightning, say, and CoinSwap and JoinMarket and all of these things as simply something that you're locking capital in for a return, it kind of becomes zero sum. Like you can't lock the same coin, or well, not lock in the sense, but you can't reserve the same coin for coin swap making and also lock it in the Lightning Network unless you create, some atomicity across those two layers.
Yeah, so I guess capital can't be used for routing Lightning transactions at the same time as being in a fidelity bond used for CoinSwap. That's right. I suppose for that argument, for that I would respond good because that means that Bitcoins will be more scarce. Because another
Well, no,
reason people want to buy Bitcoins is because they can make money from them, right? And
I don't mean
then their
the
demand will go up.
fidelity bond. I mean like reserving coins to do coin swaps with. Like you're kind of you have to pick one or the other. Like, do I want to try and make money with these coins coin swapping as a maker, or do I want to lock it into the Lightning Network for routing? Whereas if you could atomically link, a payment across the Lightning Network into a coin swap, I see a potential for somebody to make the Lightning routing fees, but also be charging a coin swap fee for participating in a coin swap route.
I can't, maybe I have to think about it a bit more, but I can't think of a way to make that work because in the Lightning, for coins to be in Lightning Network channels, they'd have to be in these two of two multisigs and they stay unspent like indefinitely. Well, with CoinSwap, it's a fundamentally an on thing, an on-chain protocol. So the coins would be in the maker's wallet until, under their unilateral control until they make a coin swap. So I don't know how it can be both in the maker's unilateral control and also in a lightning channel in a bilateral control. So I don't know if that can be made to work ever, but maybe there could be a way. I don't know.
Well, not saying bold. I'm saying like let's say you're a coin swap maker. We make our address on chain. We sign the HTLC, and then I front load that. Atomically link the same HTLC across a routing a Lightning payment routed through the Lightning Network to another maker that I'm involved with, who receives coin over the Lightning Network. And then he engages in his coin swap down the link. Like you see what I mean? Kind of just make a Lightning payment part of the hop in a routed coin swap.
I think in that situation there could be liquidity problems because the lightning part of the routes can be you have to think about incoming channel out and outbound liquidity and channel rebalancing and things. And the whole point of the liquidity market in CoinSwap is that those problems aren't there, but instead the liquidity is paid for straight away and then returned back by when the CoinSwap's finished. So, okay, so if you had that, like if you had a coin swap and then goes through a Lightning and then through another coin swap, it would mean that you're limiting yourself to lower amounts, which is the kind of thing that Lightning can do. So I don't know if that's valuable.
Well, I mean, with atomic multipath routing, like the liquidity constraint wouldn't be as much as it would be without it.
Yeah, hopefully, I guess, yeah.
Well, whoopsies, looks like we lost Janine. So I guess I kind of hop out of the coin swap stuff for a little bit.
Before we do,
the
I've got a question for you guys, which is I'm trying to come up with a name for the project. So I don't think having CoinSwap as a name is not a good name. There's a few reasons. One of them is it sounds a bit like a trade. There's actually a local Bitcoin's clone called Local CoinSwap, and this has nothing to do with trading, it's privacy. So I've come up with two possible names, and if you could tell me which is do you think better. One is PET, which is short for Privacy Enhanced Transactions. So you can imagine in your wallet, you click a tick box which says enable PET, enable privacy enhanced transactions. And the other possible name is Indigo, which is a semi backronym for invisible disconnected transactions. And then you'd click that you want to make an Indigo transaction. I don't know. What do you think of those names?
I would, my inclination is to go for pet just because I can think of a wallet having a little animation of like a dog or a cat when you click that button, which would attract people to actually using it.
I think
That's a cute
Indigo
idea.
sounds like a badass intelligence operations code name.
That's interesting. Thanks.
Mean, I don't know. I honestly kind of like both for different reasons.
Yeah, that's
Naming
annoying
things
that
is hard.
everyone said that. Yeah, naming things is hard. I think so far my best name that I've managed to come up with is Electrum Personal Server, because that just gets the whole idea in one sentence. It's like the concrete down to the all the details that you need to know is just in this name.
But yeah, I kind of jumped though out of the coin swap for a bit. You recently got the grant from the Human Rights Foundation for coin swap development. So did you kind of receive that pseudonymously, like ZMN SCP XJ from Square?
Z-Man.
Yeah, pretty much. Alex Gladstein messaged me one day, and can we talk on the phone? I said yeah, and he said, he told me the whole story, and then I was in a, his someone else there was there on the chat with from the Human Rights Foundation. He said send me a Bitcoin address, and I said here you go, and then they sent the money, and that was that. Really, can't get more pseudonymous, I guess.
Yeah, I'm just glad to see, you finally getting some support in some substantial way for development. I'm going to write that folk ballad one day, Belcher. But it's like, you've just been hacking away at a lot of different stuff in this space, surviving off your own income and donations for the entire time I've known you. Like, it's finally, like, yes, some recognition and some funding for all of the nice things you're building for us.
Yeah, and it's pretty great, and it's very like as you said previously, I'd eke out a living with the other way, and now this is more it's more sustainable, I guess. I can spend my time only on this, and that's great. It's good for Bitcoin and good for privacy, I think.
So just kind of like open up the whole topic, I guess. Like what's your general attitude on like privacy in the space as a whole right now? Because it's much more improved than say 5 years ago, but it just feels to me like there's just this general attitude that like Bitcoin is private and fungibility is solved now. That's kind of permeating the space. And we're strictly speaking, not even close to that.
Yeah, that's right. It's not even close. Hopefully CoinSwap will improve, but even then, I think the kind of the way I think about it is privacy is something that people have to you have to kind of if it, the way it may happen is that people will be victims of privacy attacks. So, and they might be victims of privacy attacks, and then that will motivate large numbers of people to adopt this technology, especially if it's a tick box they can just click. So, for example, there's a thing that I find quite hard is I'm seeing Bitcoin used quite a lot in places I'm not familiar with. So, for example, in Venezuela or Nigeria, and like I've been listening to the podcast from Stefan Larrivé podcast where he talks to some people from there, and they talk about like Telegram groups of traders who just make 10 Bitcoin trades like all the time, and that there's huge amounts of liquidity there, and they're just done in their networks without going through local Bitcoins or anything like that. And that's something I don't know anything about. I've never been to those countries. I don't know how the local culture is or anything like that. And so I think I'm the wrong person to ask for how it's actually working on the ground. But in terms of what I guess might happen is maybe in Venezuela, perhaps the government will get into one of these Telegram groups and then use Bitcoin's privacy flaws to figure out everyone's identity there and then arrest some of them. And then the people who remain, they're going to say, okay, I need to take privacy really seriously. I'm going to adopt all this stuff, like never reuse addresses and that kind of thing. I remember for me, the other, a couple of like a year or two ago, I sold some Bitcoins and the person who, like the coins I was meant to send to him, it was in a reused address. So all his trades were going to this one single address, and you could put it in a blockchain explorer and see the transactions going back years, basically. And I told him like, "Hey, you want to not do that, right?" And blah blah blah. And he says, "No, it's fine. It doesn't harm me. I don't care. It's just easier when I have." For his point of view is when he has repeat customers, they always know the address is correct. So I don't know what you do there, but maybe one day he'll be. If he's Venezuelan, he might be arrested, and then he'll, not reuse addresses. But actually, he wasn't. I mean, he was in my country, right? In a country, in the West here, with nothing in the UK, in London, so he had nothing really to worry about in terms of the law.
I mean, I guess that's kind of a good use case for why stuff like payment codes, like with Paynims, are valuable, because then you do have a repeat identifier that someone can just look at and recognize and remember, but you're also not tempted to engage in re address reuse.
Yeah, that's right. That's one possibility.
Yeah, I'm actually kind of, it's kind of flabbergasting to me that Samurai are the only ones, at least that I'm aware of right now, who've implemented that. Like, that seems like such a common sense feature to really try to roll out as widely as you can.
I don't think it's actually that common sense that there's a lot of there's quite a few downsides. So hold on one second, let me just find a document.
Or are
Yeah, I
we gonna
mean,
nitpick
when.
the signaling on chain?
Yeah, I'm.
Yeah,
Well, I
that's
mean,
one
I'd.
thing that it requires on chain, but also in terms of the problems it solves, you can get a lot of things by being really disciplined with not reusing addresses. So for example, one problem it doesn't solve is a thing I've been calling the mystery shopper attack. And that's a thing where, I don't know, suppose you want to donate to someone, and if you donate them a very small amount of bitcoins and then watch where they go on chain. So if they've been merged into one big transaction into other that goes somewhere, you could say, okay, all these other inputs are actually all the other donations to this person. And that works the same with stealth addresses. You have to take extra care to beat the mystery shopper payment attack. And another thing that stealth addresses don't solve is censorship, because they use the same public key, like for all the payments, that public key could be censored. So for example, if someone keeps all their bitcoins on a Coinbase account and keeps, they want to donate to something here, then Coinbase could say, aha, you're donating to this public key, which is a stealth address public key, but still we're not going to allow it. And re change having a new address you use each time beats that, because Coinbase won't know that this address actually belongs to whatever the person you're donating to, some WikiLeaks or something like that. So they okay, I suppose that's censorship resistance rather than privacy. But they I've thought a bit about stealth addresses, and I don't think they're that common sense, really, in my view.
Yeah, I was just thinking of it more from the user's perspective, like someone who wouldn't want to handle, creating a new address each time, or they want to be able to manage that for, customers who are not very technical and just want to be able to know, okay, this identifier matches the same one that I used last time. Like from their end, it just prevents address reuse, but yeah, there's still the activity that happens after that can be a problem.
Really, those objects are completely the wrong words. Like, they should never have been called addresses, because the word address makes you think it's like an email address or a mail address
Yeah.
that you think are reused. And I have some hope for those when Lightning becomes more popular. Probably what's going to happen is they'll be used in those BIP21 URIs. You remember them, where it says Bitcoin colon and then the Bitcoin address and some other metadata you can add. And I can imagine that people will eventually use Bitcoin by paying to that, and that will have both a Bitcoin address and a Lightning invoice. And Lightning invoices change all the time. And then people will just call this one thing. We'll just call it an invoice, a Bitcoin. Give me your invoice. I want to pay you. Give me your invoice. Here's my invoice so you can pay me. And then it'll be natural for people to never reuse them because it won't have the word address. I don't know, maybe that will help, who knows?
Well, I mean, it's like, I still think that it would be a net improvement in a lot of cases because, like you said, that the trader, and I know a decent amount of traders who do the same thing with address reuse, that all centers around making it a simple thing to interact with somebody who doesn't understand this stuff. And I mean, yeah, you still have to take care managing all the spends from any of those outputs, but it's still like it shifts the default from the instant coins are set somewhere, things are correlated to now the user has to proactively do something to correlate that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's a fair point that it changes from a passive attack to an active attack. That's right.
Yeah, there's still a lot of work to do in this space as far as privacy goes.
Yeah, agreed.
Especially when you still have so many people that are willing to dump their personal information into various silos that basically, at the end of the day, yeah, you can use all the privacy tools that are available, but you're always going to have this target painted on your back because you very clearly identified yourself as a Bitcoiner to some corporate entity who is going to retain that data, whether they want to or not, for several years, if not longer.
Yeah, the KYC thing is a huge, a big problem, and it's not. I don't know if that's something. Maybe it's not something that something like CoinSwap or CoinJoin can solve. You need to solve it by go working around it by resisting and having your own trading networks or just using Bitcoin as money that you spend in other places. So I don't know what the future holds.
Yes, a really interesting comment though. So I think it was Nicolas Dorier. He said that that people have actually asked him not to coin join coins that they've sent him. So they'll basically say, "Oh, I want to, donate some money to you, but I don't want you to coin join it or use any privacy tools afterwards because it's coming from an exchange and my exchange account could get closed or, I could get questions based on the fact that you did coin join." And I've actually never thought of that. No one's ever asked me that question, but I feel like, yeah, that could absolutely happen because at the moment we're kind of just thinking of, oh, what if a exchange user goes to CoinJoin their own coins? But then there's also this pressure that could exist of someone is sending coins from their own exchange account, or even they have an exchange account and the exchange is able to correlate coins that they have in a different wallet with their exchange account and identity. There's going to be this like kind of seeping pressure beyond that person to other people to not coin join, or at least they're going to try to do that as a result.
Yeah, and the end game for that is that eventually probably self-custody of coins will become incredibly will become under pressure because the exchanges like they'd love it if you just kept all your coins at their exchange and whenever you take them out they'll put all kinds of barriers up for you, I'm sure. So yeah, I suppose the only solution is resistance. Like that guy, if he can get his bitcoins from somewhere else and not from an exchange, or possibly I don't know, maybe he uses CoinSwap when it exists, and it's not obvious that something like that happened.
I mean, it's things like that really why I have a problem with like rampant advice to just coin join all your coins always, because like all kinds of situations like that can occur. And it's really like you should think through, do you need this privacy right now? Like it's a You know what I mean? Like your default shouldn't just be to add this fingerprint to something tied to you because that could go wrong in so many ways. I mean, like imagine the IRS coming knocking on the door and it's audit time and now something tied to you goes off into a coin join. Well, maybe now they're going to crawl 10 times further up your ass rather than just, okay, you answered my questions, have a nice day.
Yeah, I guess that's possible. But they, what was I going to say? So a thing of the coin join is because they're detectable, there's people who use coin joins have an incentive to try and get everyone else to use them. They basically have to go on Twitter and Reddit and beg everyone else, oh yeah, please coin join, it'll be good. It's good for you. But really, they're saying it's good for me It's good for my coins. It improves my privacy. And quite a nice thing of CoinSwap and how it's undetectable is you don't need to do that anymore because your anonymity set is everyone else who uses Bitcoin normally without doing anything special because your CoinSwaps look just like their Bitcoins. So I suppose that'll be nice because then there might be less sort of guilt tripping around of, oh yeah, you should all coin join for every transaction. Of course, another reason that there's a talk going around that you should coin join every transaction is because then the centralized coordinators make more fees, right? They want more business, don't they?
Yeah, I mean that's definitely a side of it, but it's just like, you know what I mean? These are the tools we have right now, and they're way better than nothing. But you know, it's something to think through. You know, like I think one of the first questions anybody should ask themselves before getting into this space, getting Bitcoin, is asking, are you okay with your government potentially knowing that you have Bitcoin because of records kept somewhere? Or are you not okay with that? And that should be the first thing you ask yourself, because it's not just a magic, you know, run it through the mixer and you don't have any problems anymore. Like that, you could be in a situation where you have no problems and using that mixer actually creates them. And it's great that these tools exist for people who want to use them, you know, aware of these things, who need to use them. But you know, a lot of people could wind up creating big problems for themselves just blindly going coin join because that's what I was told to do.
Yeah, that's right. And one possible situation of how this all works, one possible like scenario is that the first few people, I don't know, the first couple of people over the next 5 or 10 years, they use CoinSwap or CoinJoin, and then the authorities like crack down on them. I don't know, maybe they do a CoinSwap, and then the coins they sent actually end up being sent to Iran, like a sanctioned country. And then someone breaks down their door and says, "Hey, why were you sending coins to Iran?" And blah blah blah. And then you know, this guy just says, "Look, I was actually using CoinSwap. You know, look at this thing." And then I'm innocent, basically. You can prove that you know he's got the CoinSwap application. And then the authorities will learn. They're like, "Oh, okay, maybe we can't track Bitcoin so well." So we might end up in an effect where the first couple of people get they have to answer questions that will be very unpleasant for them. But then they're sacrifice. I mean, I know it's obviously, you know, horrible for them. These are the people breaking down their door, but their sacrifice will help everyone else because it will help the authorities learn that they can't just like that. Yeah, that's one scenario where this all happens. Because after that happens, when people realize that, when analysts realize that every transaction they see could be a coin swap, then I think they'll just give up. Unless other attacks are found, but there might be nothing. I don't know what else they could do. That's why I'm kind of keen of in. I'm eager in when it's all created and deployed that we create this meme of, hey, isn't that CoinSwap?
I mean, I hope that that's the case, but I have a feeling that they're not going to give up. They're just going to increase either the pressure to get everyone to stop self-custodying, or they're going to increase their level of pseudoscience beyond what they're already practicing. Like we saw with the Chainalysis webinar, I can't remember when it was, but it was pointed out by Ruben, where they basically said in the war, risk what they consider risky is not necessarily illicit, but as I pointed out recently on Twitter, what they tell their clients is to basically equate whiskey with illicit, or at least the potential to be illicit, which is effectively they make it the same thing, and that's really annoying because that's affecting how their clients are reacting and viewing privacy enhancing technology. They're looking at it all as, yes, it is risky, but we're going to treat it as illicit because we don't know. And that's going to get really annoying going forward, especially with like, because I had a whole thread about WorldCheck and how WorldCheck is kind of similar to these blockchain surveillance companies, where the sourcing and how people come to be added to lists like that is like really, it's really disgusting, and there's no like really solid methodology behind it, and yet it still affects people every day. Like it locks people out of the financial system, And so, yeah, I hope that their response is to be like, well, can't do anything much anymore, but I have a feeling like with all the money behind it, that they're probably just going to ramp up their pseudoscientific practices.
Yeah, that's right. And then at the end of the day, if it's something risky or illicit, the outcome is the same if you're locked out, if your account is closed. I guess what will be, I don't know, the community, people who this will end up having to resist, they'll have to somehow convince them that look, privacy is a thing, and you can't just assume transactions are like this, and then maybe that will show to people that the pseudoscience is wrong.
Well, I mean, in America at least, I see another potential route to go. Court.
Yeah, that's right.
Americans don't have a right to financial privacy from their banks or their financial institutions, but they do to the public at large. And just the nature of Bitcoin being so just intuitively different than a private database in a silo. I see a very strong argument there that the use of these tools are perfectly legal in the sense that you are just protecting your financial privacy from the public. And nothing about using these tools prevents you from providing a proof of provenance or where those coins actually came from to a private entity. You know what I mean? Like I can coin join all day and I can still go back to where I first went into that mix and sign a message to prove this is where my coin came from.
Yeah, that's right. So I wonder if a solution might be that you go, I mean, I don't want to give them ideas, but suppose you go to an exchange and buy bitcoins, and then they require you, every time you make a transaction on chain, they require you to either prove that you still own the coins or somehow prove that they've gone to some other place, some exchange. That could be a thing. Although that would break the system as well, because then you have to, every time you make a transaction, you have to get email your exchange, which would be a bit silly.
My solution so far is just not to. So far I haven't used any KYC services, and when I say that, like, I'm a very boring person when it comes to the things that I spend my money on. So anyone who would, take an interest in me just because I say I don't use KYC and stuff, you're going to be very disappointed because I'm the most plain, boring person you could think of. And the reason I don't do it is more because just like I don't trust any of these companies or services to protect that information. And it's not even so much of like, what would the government do if they had this information, which I like, there are so many different ways that they could obtain that besides these, fintech companies. I'm just thinking of the fact that I don't trust any of them to keep it secure from everyone else, like the public. It's going to eventually just get release somewhere onto, darknet markets or whatever, and I can't control it at that point. So the only control I can exercise is just not give it to anyone. And people sometimes ask, well, that must be really hard to do. And actually, I think people overestimate how technically knowledgeable I am and how technically knowledgeable you have to be to actually use Bitcoin and get Bitcoin that way without doxing yourself to everyone left and right.
Yeah, I agree, and it's not actually that hard. So the first few times I bought Bitcoin was actually just in cash in person, and I didn't know much about Bitcoin then. It was just I just went to some, got some guy's phone number. We met up somewhere. It was just like buying something on Craigslist. I gave him cash, and then he sent me first to the. I shouldn't, there's the whole protocol. He just sent coins to my QR code, and I saw the confirmation happen. I just gave him cash, and it was. You didn't really need it. You just need to know how to use a wallet. It was easy. And these days we have lots of. So have you guys seen? I have like this. There's this GitHub which someone else made, which lists lots and lots of ways to get Bitcoin or sell Bitcoin without KYC, the no K, the peer-to-peer list. And that didn't really. That's kind of a new thing. And I think a lot of people are using that. There's and Bisc, of course, is one example. So Yeah, you can survive like that, depending on your use case.
Yeah, I think buying cash is definitely the way to go if that's possible. My first coin purchase was meeting some suburban soccer mom in a Starbucks and going, this is weirdly like, but not like a drug deal.
Do we happen to know who this suburban soccer mom is?
Nope.
Oh, interesting.
Like it was the weirdest experience of my life showing up expecting like some nerdy like InfoSec chick, and it's just like, nope, some soccer mom just trading something.
Yeah, well, maybe I guess that's the power of assumptions, right? People can surprise you a bit.
Well, I don't know, guys. I think I mostly plumbed out all the stuff I wanted to get into. Janine Belcher, you guys got anything else you want to talk about?
Nope.
I don't know.
I am ready for the announcement, though.
Surprise, Belcher. We have a surprise announcement for you.
Cool, what's that?
Well, Janine, you want to drop the news or should I?
You can do it.
Well, it's no $50,000 grant from the Human Rights Foundation, but in the next couple days we are going to peel off 0.1 BTC and send that your way for help with CoinSwap and join market development. And I at least am going to meme people on Twitter to try and match that to some degree.
Well, that's wonderful. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, I mean, man, you have produced a lot of stuff in this space that I have personally benefited from, and the least we can do is pass on, some of the thank you.
Yeah, that's very much appreciated. Thank you.
Yeah, and we've actually trying to make it for quite a while, but we figured this would be a good opportunity.
Yeah, cool. That's very nice.
So I guess it's our little contribution back for all the cool toys you've made for us.
Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah, do you guys use like Electrum Personal Server and I suppose other things? Yeah,
Got it sitting
cool.
on a desktop right behind me right now, hooked up to my node.
Yeah, nice.
But yeah, I guess this was a real fun one. Honestly, kind of shocked I haven't pestered you to come on before now, but thanks for coming on. It was fun and I hope educational.
Yeah, thanks for having me. We can do this again. So in a few days, I'm going to send an email to the mailing list about a detailed protocol, and that could be an interesting thing to talk about as well, or other stuff, I don't know.
Ooh, we might try to pull you right back for a back-to-back then.
Yeah, sounds good.
All right, but I hope everybody enjoyed listening, and catch you later, punks.
Yeah, thanks, guys. See you.
Bye.